Many, many friends of Alexandre's are in the audience tonight. So many of you already know what a talented, interesting person he is. But bear with me as I tell you a little bit about his fascinating background. Alexandre is he's a musician, he's an educator, a composer, and an ethnomusicologist. He holds a Bachelor of Music with a double major in Music Theory and Composition, a Master of Arts degree in Music Education from Columbia University Teacher College, and he's a recipient of the Mellon Fellowship, where he earned a Master of Arts and a Master of Philosophy in Ethnomusicology from Columbia University. As a musician, he performs classical, jazz, rock, and non-Western music on the double bass, guitar, piano, and percussion. His compositions are frequently performed in the United States, Europe, and in Asia. He had a world premiere performance of an orchestral composition called Metamorphose, which he conducted at Carnegie Hall and was critically acclaimed and received a standing ovation. As an ethnomusicologist, he's conducted fieldwork for over 15 years in countries all over the world, where he researched, investigated issues of acculturation, community, music identity in an urban setting, and concepts of talent, charisma, and leadership in music. And for the past 6 years, he's been researching the esoteric and therapeutic properties of sound from scientific, shamanic, historical, and practical perspectives. We're gonna hear a little bit about that tonight. And this has led him to design a setting he refers to as sound meditation, which helps participants disconnect from habitual patterns. And I think we're gonna be blessed with a little performance tonight. Alexandre is also a frequent guest lecturer at major institutions, including Georgetown University, Princeton University, Columbia University, Michigan University, NYU. He's been at the American Museum of Natural History, the Metropolitan Museum of New York, Berkeley Museum, and tonight we're lucky to have him at the National Arts Club. That's the official introduction. I just want to say a few words on a personal note, because Alexandre's been become a close friend in the last few years. And if you don't know him, he is he's an extraordinary person. The passion and the curiosity that he brings to music, I feel like he brings to really all aspects of his life. And so we're really lucky to have him here tonight. Alexandre Tannous.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Robert, for the wonderful introduction. I'd like to thank you and thank the Art and Technology Committee, National Arts Club, and everyone who is here. Thank you so much. You won't be disappointed, even if it's going to get weird, but it's going to get good. The talk is going to be very informative, revealing, but I had to tailor it because this is stuff that I can talk about for at least 10 or 15 hours nonstop. So nonetheless, you're going to get a very good dose of the most important things, and not just on the introductory level. It's going to go into somewhat far out theories. But I left some things out that would beg more explanations. So please do understand that I'm limited with time, but I will explore and develop things as much as I can with the given time. So the talk is about the esoteric and therapeutic properties of sound from various perspectives. What I'm doing here is social scientific study without discriminating between cultures, methodologies, perspectives. I'm focusing on three different perspectives. The first one is the Western scientific, the second one is the shamanic societal beliefs, and the third one is the Eastern philosophical approach. And the more I delved into this research, the more it started making sense and truly connecting the dots together. A lot of the things that you're gonna hear about and see tonight are gonna be facts. I will tell you when we get to a certain point where I personally think what's happening. I'm an ethnomusicologist, and for those of you who don't know what an ethnomusicologist is, ethnomusicology is a field that studies music as a sociocultural phenomenon, and the ultimate goal is to understand human beings by studying culture through music, kind of similar to anthropology of music. But I'm also bringing my knowledge as a composer, a musician, someone who knows music theory as well, and someone who has experience with meditation. And all of this, what I'll be talking about tonight, is a better understanding of music and how it impacts our consciousness. So the revealing aspect is the part that deals or relates to music, but also how music affects us. I started with a few questions, mostly dealing with why are we so drawn to music? What is it offering us? What have we done with this attraction? How have we effectively used it in the past and in the present? Various questions of the sort. And what do we know about it now? Who knows about it more than others? In the West, it's mostly limited to entertainment and religious also settings and different settings, but for the most part, everybody agrees that it's entertainment, and that can also be something good. It does not have to be low level. But the ancients use it for far more profound reason, healing. So in this talk, we're gonna get to understand what this is about. So I'm only using, excuse me, I'm suffering from allergies today. I will be showing you some things in the PowerPoint presentation. I won't be focusing so much on it. I will be doing a lot of talking, but I will be including some information, but mostly images, no graphs. There won't be any graphs. Edgar Cayce, you all know who Edgar Cayce is. Sound is the medicine of the future. Truly, that's what I'm genuinely starting to believe firmly. And of course, some of you may have heard it, some of you are familiar with the working of music on the therapeutic level from a field that is known as sound healing. I tend to not call it sound healing, although yes, a person in the right setting and in the right mindset can get to a level where one would experience true healing. But I try not to splurge so much with the word healing. It's a profound word, and it's been misused, overused, and it's become a little bit trite. So I'm not a sound healer, I'm a researcher, although I do facilitate the sound meditation experience, which is based on my thorough research. But I'm not a healer. I'm someone who understands what needs to happen for the person to be able to experience the inner healer, the inner teacher, and I will tell you how later on. So, this is a sentence that you all know. What does that mean? We never ask what this means. Those who know about the Bible say, oh, logos, you know, it's ancient Greek concept. Well, it started taking different proportion, this sentence. And in this talk, you will get to see the other side further. So, one of my heroes, if you want to understand the universe, think energy, frequencies, and vibrations, Nikola Tesla. It's a pity that not so many people know who he was, although we use most of his inventions. But he's someone who explored a lot, this is over 100 years ago, with using free energy and getting truly to understand the power that's in the planet and that we don't take advantage of. So before we start delving deeper, we're gonna address a little bit some interesting aspects about mathematics in nature. Because really, when we talk about sound, this is mathematics and musical ratios. fractal geometry. Many of you are familiar with this branch of mathematics. It's a field that was founded in the discoverer of fractal geometry is Benoît Mandelbrot, a French mathematician who came later on to the US and worked for IBM. And he discovered what became a standard part of mathematics in geometry, basically fractal geometry, which is very different from Euclidean geometry. And the value of this is tremendous, and it's helping us understand what the world is around us. And we also started using this knowledge to do a lot of visual effects in films, for example. If, let's say, there's a backdrop in a film and they're shooting in a studio and they want to make the backdrop to be mountains or a desert or whatever, this is all done through software, and fractals are used. Some of the things you can make art looking like this. And I'll play a short video. So as you zoom in on the tiniest part, you'll find that this little part becomes a whole world, and you can keep going to infinity. You get the idea. I don't want to lose you. Good. Yeah. Another very important thing that we've known a lot, we've known about it for a long time, is the Fibonacci sequence. This is also something that manifests in nature in so many things, plants and humans, and it affects us a lot. This aesthetics affected so much the way we see aesthetics. We prefer certain ratios, and the golden mean or the golden ratio came out of it. For example, this is all the working of Fibonacci. There was another very tempting video, but I wanted to stay away from. So this manifests in trees and plants, and also the golden ratio proportion. Leonardo da Vinci used it a lot, even in Parthenon hall. The proportions are highly used in so many things as they manifest around us. Another person's research is Masaru Emoto, who is an author and entrepreneur. The value of Emoto's research is basically studying water crystals. He would subject water to specific emotions, intentions, words, and music, and would freeze the water and would look under a microscope at the small crystals, and they would have different shape depending on what kind of words were spoken or music was played. So this is water crystal from the Fujiwara Dam, which is polluted. And this is after Buddhist prayer. This is with an imperative, do it. Having negative vibration. Once again. And this is scientific too. So if you were to do the experiment, you'd get to similar result. Or so more and more we find that the material world around us is affected by us in an invisible way without really touching it. Just the fact that we can have certain intention or say certain words, it can affect water, well, people as well. So what could that be? Either magnetism or electricity or electromagnetic energy, basically. I'm sure you've all encountered a person you felt great with this person without even knowing them, or you felt bad vibes. We call this vibes or chemistry. Well, it's electromagnetic. We're learning more and more now about the power of heart. The heart is up to 5,000 times magnetically more powerful than the brain, and over 100 times more electrically powerful than the brain as well. So something in us affects the world around us. The only thing that's in common between all past and contemporary religions, even animist religions, prayers. What are prayers? Intentions. Intentions, this ties into a theory in mathematics. The gist of it is called Bell's non-locality. Bell's non-locality tells us that if there are two particles that are connected, even if you distance one might be here in this room, another one at the end of our galaxy, they would still be connected to each other, regardless of time and space, or space-time fabric. In quantum physics, they're called entangled. The theory of entanglement is very much big right now. And we don't understand how, but based on mathematics, we know that this is possible. So something can affect the physical world around us without us doing something to it, just feeling something internally. So you can imagine how music affects us when our body is about 80% water. Not only sound affects the body, but also the neurochemistry, and this is what we're finding more and more now. Cymatics. This is also something we've known about for some time, over two centuries. It was discovered by Ernst Chladni, who is a German physicist and mathematician. Musician. And often called the father of acoustics. So what Chladni did, he basically got a metallic plate, thin, and he put salt on it and started bowing the metallic plate with a bow. And that bow caught the resonant frequency and vibration, started moving and eventually started humming and started displacing the salt. So the salt, and we're going to watch a video actually. So the parts of the plate that were vibrating the most caused the salt to be moved to the parts that are vibrating less or not at all. And as you change the frequency, this vibration changes and you get a different image as a result. What does this mean? It means that a frequency, a specific note, has a 3D image. Again, sound can change matter just by subjecting. Yeah. So here are some other fascinating cymatic patterns. This is a research that a German researcher by the last name Lauterwasser did, and he started noticing a similarity between patterns in animals and cymatics. I'll show you a couple later on. They're pretty reminiscent to mandalas, right? And we know that mandalas are found in many cultures, American Indian, in voodoo, in Tibet, in India, everywhere. So this is part of Latovas's book. So this is a tortoise shell. And notice how similar these patterns are. There were other photos, but I didn't want to put too many, of leopard patterns and zebras. It's very, very similar. So it's curious. This, of course, this begs more scientific research to find how far does it go. But maybe sound does have an effect on things that are around us more than we think. So these are different cymatic patterns to different notes. And notice they change dramatically, even though you're just shifting by half step. For those of you who are not familiar with music, this is, so A, white key, this is the very next black key on the piano, and then the very next. And you go. So, find similarity, crop circles. We know that few people can do, and they caught some people doing crop circles and they proved it, but it's hard to believe that all of them are made by people. They're very, very complex sacred geometry, and maybe there is something in nature that's causing this that we're not aware of it yet, but of course, we rush into making the conclusion, no, we don't know about it, we're not aware of something like this, then it must be someone playing a prank. Okay, sound or acoustic levitation. This is something that scientists have been exploring for quite some time. This is a short video of how this can happen. Scientists can do it with light objects, allowing the scientists to bypass gravity. And you change the frequency, the sine wave is changing, and you can do various things with that. You can lift heavier object or move them around. This is used in pharmaceuticals as well. Another short video. Yes, indeed. This is the sound that's... No. This is an older video. This is from about 25 years ago. That's why I'm keeping the volume down. What they're playing, they actually... sometimes they play more than one note. They're also playing with harmonics, which I will talk about. All of this, yes? No. We're not there yet. Another thing sound does, phenomenon is called synesthesia. Synesthesia is crossing of the senses. Every time you hear something, during meditation, for example, or eyes closed, you may get some visuals. Some people are born synesthetic. Two very famous composers from the 20th century, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov and Olivier Messiaen, were synesthetic. They would associate specific key signatures to specific colors. So some people are very sensitive. Some people have different kinds of synesthesia. They see shapes when they hear numbers. So there are different forms of synesthesia. Basically, anytime the senses cross, that's called synesthesia. Some people experience them on substances. There's a theory that it's probably, you know, with hallucinogens, probably these visions come because of the compound, and a vision becomes very significant. But endogenous chemicals can be influenced by breathing and meditation, and this is what yogis do. Now we're getting into the interesting stuff, harmonic overtones. An overtone is any frequency higher than the fundamental frequency of a sound. The fundamental and the overtones together are called partials. Harmonics are partials whose frequencies are integer multiples of the fundamental. These overlapping terms are variously used when discussing the acoustic behavior of musical instruments. Harmonics are found in nature to give us a difference between a tone color and another, or timbre and another. The sound of one bird versus another. Just the sound, actually, not the melody, the actual tone color. Or the sound of my voice versus Rob's voice, and so on and so forth. For us to navigate in the world, we need some system to get information. It's easy to figure it out when it comes to vision, but we really don't know so much about the auditory cortex. We know so much about how the other senses function in the brain and what areas are involved, etc. Scientists know very, very little when it comes to really understanding how the hearing mechanism works, not just the ear, but also once the information, the vibration goes to the auditory cortex. And the auditory cortex is somewhere around here, above the ear on both sides. But we're able to navigate the world and gaining three-dimensional aspect as well, through sound. Probably notice when you have a cold, a hard cold, and your sinuses are clogged, and it affects your hearing, and you feel out of balance, right? Okay, it's not an illusion, because sound is helping you find your way, the physical world also. And in a deep sound meditation, when I work on people around their body, they use complete sense of the material world around them, even that they have a body, even to the extent where they become absent altogether. Sound can do that when you change the surrounding. But we use it so much to get information. You're crossing the street and you hear some noise, you can distinguish right away that this is a bike and not a six-wheel truck. Or, you know. So harmonic overtones give us the difference between a C plate on a flute and that same C plate on an oboe. Basically, these overtones, which I'm going to show you in detail. When you pluck a string, for example, so this is the string vibrating. But as it's vibrating and giving you the open string, let's say it's a C. This is C. But the string also vibrates in twos at the same time, and in threes, and in four, and it goes on to infinity. Now, this point right here is called a partial. This is a C. This point, as the string is vibrating, it's a still point. If you lightly touch the string, and you've probably seen guitar players or string players do this, producing harmonics, which are very light and eerie sounds, they sound different than actual stopped string, where the note is being depressed, the string is being depressed to generate a note. It's called harmonics. You get an octave higher. Octave is eight notes apart, for those of you who don't know music. So this would be C, this is octave higher C. And you lightly touch the string and you get that C. And if you lightly break the string into three equal parts, you get a G. And then this would be another C at different points. And this would be E, and then G, and goes on and on. Pythagoras, Ptolemy, so many people in the past, and 1,000 or 2,000 years ago, have been obsessed with trying to understand sound, spending so much time on divisions of strings and trying to come up with good understanding of what sound is. This is not just the current obsession. Actually, the ancients were more interested in sound and exploring it in far more meaningful and true way than us right now. We tend to make choices. Oh, no, we can't understand here. Let's not go there. It's not interesting. We tend to stick with whatever we can measure, and that's the problem with Western science, is an obsession with measuring, with studying things that we can measure and limiting it to that. So this is where we start to deal with mathematics here, and this is, once again, nature. Truly, mathematics are the universal language. People say music. Well, music, there's understanding, there's theoretical system. It could be different from one culture to another, but mathematics are. And even if you are somewhere else in this galaxy or a different galaxy.
Are these pitches on the right side? Are these pitches considered Western tempered tuning?
I'm getting to the temperament in just a bit. So here, for example, the string vibrating. If this is the middle part of the string, if you try to stop the string or press it lightly right before the middle, both parts are not going to vibrate. If you press it right in the middle, then you get one harmonic and both sides will be vibrating similarly here. So these numbers here are the frequencies and the hertz. This is the scent, a half step in sound currently, in equal temperament is equal to 100 cents. So the distance between C and C sharp, or C sharp to D. So this is a wonderful depiction of the string in its all vibrations going to infinity. And this is why you get the different harmonic overtones to infinity, even to a level where the human being cannot hear the harmonics anymore. But if you were to use electronic equipment or computer to analyze the harmonic spectrum, you will find the entire thing. As far as the spectrum of that specific string or instrument would allow you to hear, as far as a different signature, basically. So the harmonic overtones in my voice are aligning in a very different way. This partial is a little more present, the third one is less present, and so on, giving me a very unique sounding voice, very different than Rob's, for example. And if there's another person who has similar voices, right, then their harmonic series are pretty close to mine. So this is basically how we get similarity of tone color or timbre. Once again, this is something that's important for survival. For, let's say, a long time ago in hunter-gatherer society, two men going hunting, and they want to be able to distinguish from the sound they're hearing whether that's an angry bear or a bird, you know. So it's not superfluous, it's really important. It's not just related to music, it's related to navigating in the world. So this is the harmonic series up to a certain extent. It goes on to infinity, but I'm just going to show you. Don't worry about the notes, I put them right here. Just know that this, the difference between this C and that C is an octave higher, 8 notes apart. So this is the string vibrating and open. This is a low C. And the next partial is not a C. And then the third one is a G. And then
is that
a C.
Fibonacci?
Well, it's related to Fibonacci, yeah. But it gets trickier. And I'm going to spend a little more time explaining this leading to something that's very important. So, and then an E, and then a G, a B flat, and it goes on to infinity. Notice that the intervals start to shrink. And they never meet, they never stop. They go on to infinity, to the most infinite portion. Now, so this is the same spectrum. Here we're using one step. This is bass clef, left hand on the piano. This is going into higher register. Similarly, now, notice these numbers on top. These numbers are very important. These are the deviations. if you have a perfectly tuned keyboard, piano, if you were to match the harmonic overtones, they're called harmonic overtones, partials, harmonics, or overtones, all the same, depending on whether an acoustician is talking or a musician, and so on. So this partial right here is plus 2 cents. That means it's a little bit sharper than perfectly tuned G on the keyboard. And you go on to the next harmonic, and that's minus 14. So it's noticeably flat. The ear would pick up fluctuation, anything plus or minus 4. Those with a very scrutinizing ear can hear up to plus or minus 2 cents. That's very minimal. A half step, again, is 100 cents. So this is very fine minutiae. Look at this one, minus 31, and goes on. Now, this is the tuning that nature gave us. If you play any instrument, and if you were to measure these harmonic overtones, you're going to get this mathematical ratio. And what do? We create a way to temper everything. We make all of the half steps equal, making the entire octave equal to 12 equidistant half steps. And this became known as equal temperament. It started happening around 1600s, basically, and became common practice. This is something that impacted Western European music and the rest of the world, except some of the cultures that remained attached to the temperament that they use. Bach was enthralled by this idea because for the first time ever, you can actually play a piece of music and transpose it to any key you want, and that piece of music will still sound the same, having a different tonal center, but sounding the same. Before the equal temperament, the actual piece will start to sound out of tune once you start taking it into a distant key. To those who know music, if you have a piece in a key of C, you cannot transpose it in non-equal temperament to another key that has more than 4 flats or 4 sharps in a signature. The piece of music will start to sound out of tune. So Bach, for the first time, was able to play in equal temperament, and he wrote his probably most important work and the Bible for pianist, keyboard player, Das wohl temperierte Klavier, the well-tempered clavier. 2 books of preludes and fugues in every major and minor key. So, now, there are a lot of musical systems in the world that still don't use the equal temperament. I'm going to get to it in a bit, but I had another slide. Let me see where it is. Okay. Yeah. Boo. What did that do? I'll tell you what it did. But let me talk a little more about this. Classical Indian music, for example, did not adopt the equal temperament. Classical Turkish, Persian, Arabic, and several other old musical cultures. Why? Because when you drift away from what nature gave us as a blueprint to gain flexibility and efficiency in transposition, changing the key of one piece to another, something essential I'm realizing was lost. What? Well, music now, if you listen to music in any of these cultures that don't follow the equal temperament, and this is culturally known. For example, Indian classical music, you all know how you feel when you attend a classical concert or you listen to it even at home. Something happens to your consciousness. All of a sudden, you find that you're more at peace and you find that you're experiencing some solemn feeling within you, and it's bringing your energy down, relaxing, and your mind especially. And these mathematical ratios that are in music are very important for these musical cultures that I mentioned. There are many others, but I'm mentioning just those because in classical Indian and Arabic and Turkish and Persian music, there are concepts, there are agreed on cultural concepts that deal with transcendence. In Indian music, when you perform a piece of music, you stick with one rag for a bit. A rag, plural, raga, are the modes or the scales. So why do you stick with it? Why do you listen to one lengthy piece of music, or the musicians would not quickly shift the rag to something else? Because your body and energy and mind get adjusted to this mathematical ratio that's found in the overall intervallic structure of that scale that you're being subjected to. The ancient Greeks called that the ethos, the spirit, the character, the personality. And this is why those of you who are familiar with ancient Greek music, just in writing, we don't have any evidence of how it was, but there are theories. But they spoke a lot about the ethos. What the ethos was, basically, they were playing in unequal tempered music. And that music, even in systems that are still surviving right now, is going to do something to your consciousness. Assuming a few things, that you're being exposed to a certain length of time, so that it takes your body, your chemistry, neurochemistry, and the way you're listening as well. It all depends on what's happening in your head when you're being subjected with this music. There are various levels of hearing and listening. The most productive one is the judicious, attentive listening. And that is sitting and just listening and watching what your mind is doing. That means don't stop thinking of all these things that are stressing you out, or things related to something that happened yesterday, or something on your mind, or projecting into the future, or staying in the present but not paying attention to the music. No, just listen. And that's the hardest thing. It's as hard as meditating. Truly, the hardest thing for us is to sit and not do anything. So these mathematical ratios, I'll take questions at the end if that's okay, unless you have one that's really urgent. But we're going to leave room for questions. I see some people raising their hand. I'm going to give about 15, 20 minutes. So the most important thing for people in these cultures is basically to sit and listen and give your energy to the performer. And don't be hesitant at communicating to the performer what their music is doing to you. And even if it has to take to utter specific words and expressions or making any sound, there's a stock of different words and expressions in various cultures, in Indian and in classical Arabic music, that the audience, which is not a normal audience that would only applaud at the end, be polite. No, they even interrupt, they comment in the middle, but this communicates certain beautiful accepted impulsiveness and just a genuine reaction, and nothing tickles the musician but such a remark or such reaction when it's done genuinely in the right place. And they even do it even in places where it's not clearly virtuosic. It's not like a hard passage, no. Very delicate manipulation, and the connoisseurs in the audience would just either shake their head or would do something to indicate to the performer that I'm with you. And then this communicates to the musician or the musicians that, there are people here who really dig what I'm doing. They're really attuned to me. So they give more because they are judicious listeners. The more they give to the audience, the more the audience give to the performers. Ultimately, at the end, in classical Arabic music, for example, there's a state of euphoria, of ecstasy, I'm getting to it later on, called tarab. There are even words for these things. It's a widely accepted part of the culture. How are these things happening? Through the scales. Now, if you're sitting in a classical concert, that's still going to be beautiful. But few things get in the way. First, you're dealing with different mathematical ratio that's not very close to what nature gave us. It's adjusted, it's altered. I know it's just a bit, but this a bit seems to be making a lot of difference. Listen to classical Western music and listen to Indian music, even if you don't know so much about it, but just sit at home and listen, or classical Arabic. And why? Because these intervals that they're using in even a, let's say, major scale, that's found in common, or a minor scale, when you play it, it's not going to sound like the Western major scale, because the distance between one note and another is slightly different, few cents here and there. But the overall effect is having bigger impact on our consciousness. In classical Arabic, Turkish, and Persian music, there are microtones. Some of the notes are half flat, half sharp. And it's not always in the middle. That means take that half flat exactly in the middle between the F and the F sharp. If you have F half sharp, it's somewhere around there. But they feel more than they calculate. So again, where do these scales come from? Well, from here. These deviations, for example, the blue note in blues. Blue note is a note that purposely played flat. There are a lot of blue notes in blues that actually do not fit the scale as they're being played, as the notes are being played on a fixed pitch instrument. The singer might be a little higher, a little flatter, often flatter. Where does that come from? Right here. This is the culprit. This B flat, the blue note. This is very close to being in the middle. So we sense these things, and we know how much the blues have impacted the world. It's not just because of these altered notes. There's another story to it. It's because the music came from true expression. African Americans during slavery time, they needed a refuge to really talk about their deep emotions and hurt and being neglected and mistreated and all that sort of hard thing. The result was powerful musical style that impacted the world internationally and made many other musical styles emerge as a result. Jazz, rock, we wouldn't have most of contemporary musical styles without blues. No, but blues reached out to people because there are these notes that are in the cracks, these notes that you can only sing them or can only play them on a non-equal tempered instrument or an instrument that's not fretted. Any instrument where you have keys, frets, sometimes valves, although valved instruments like trumpets and French horns, etc., you can bend the pitch up or down. By manipulating your embouchure, okay? But on guitar, for you to adjust the temperament, you have to bend the string. These are notes that you can play on any fretless instrument, like violin, viola, cello, bass. String bass is my primary instrument, and I remember when I would sit and practice for an hour or two, and then go to the piano, and all of a sudden, the piano that I had, which was digital keyboard, does not go out of tune, would sound out of tune. Why? Because I was automatically playing in non-equal temperament. Musicians know this. All string players know that they have to change their intonations when they're playing, performing a concert, or doing a rehearsal with someone with a fixed pitch instrument like a piano. Why? This is a direct proof that this ratio is encoded in us. When we play, we automatically resort to this tuning that nature gave us. Nonetheless, music on equal temperament system is still powerful, and Bach is still great, played on equal temperament instrument, and Thelonious Monk and everyone else. But we are losing something very profound, and this is the thing that's causing altered states of consciousness in other musical cultures. Overtone singing. Coincidentally, all of the instruments that have been played part of the sound healing thing in the past and in the present are instruments that generate harmonic overtones. Gongs, Tibetan bowls, bells, discs, overtone singing, also called diaphonic singing, harmonic overtone singing, harmonic singing, various names, throat singing sometimes. And this is where the singer is able to generate two or more notes going simultaneously, usually the fundamental, the bass note, the first note in a series, and different partials by manipulating the vowels and forcing certain vowels in the shades between one vowel and another. I'm going to play you some example. There are various styles of overtone singing. This is one of them. It's the faint note on top. So he's singing the fundamental and changing the buccal cavity and vocal cords to pronounce or emphasize the overtone. Sometimes they sing melodies, they just sustain the fundamental, and they sing very complex melodies on all of the notes that you saw earlier. And of course, these notes are going to come out with a different tuning. Some of them may sound out of tune to us, because we're used to different tuning right now. Okay, you got the idea. So, equal temperament, and it changes things for us. This is literally, this act robbed music its power, literally. We're being deprived from yet a bigger magic in music. So, now, sound is being used in military application, no surprise. But we're seeing now that a lot of great things and a lot of bad things can be done with sound. So this made me take the ancients more seriously and to really see that when Tibetan monks use sound, or Hindus in India, or mantras, for example, a mantra or a sutra is also a sound. Sanskrit is known to have magical quality in it. Those of you who studied Sanskrit or read about it know about the scriptures. These are the hairs in the ear. We're born with 16,000 of them, and we start losing them the day we're born. Yes. Here are some facts about human hearing. 16,000 hair cells compared to 125 million photoreceptors. That's how precious your ears are. And you would be surprised to see how damaging some of these decibels are that we're being subjected to every day in city. Carry earplugs on you, believe me. It's the best investment, especially in subways. This is a great book about Sonic Warfare by Steve Goodman, but the use of sound in military applications is scary. Mind control especially. Some of the things that we're doing with sound, and I'm sure there are other things to discover. This is a great book that talks about various things that I addressed. I can recommend another several dozens, but if you were to get one or two, this is another good one. Introductory level, that we touch on important things. So, scientists are discovering that the ancients were using fractal nonlinear resonance. We're now discovering in the field of material science that non-material resonances of sound waves, microwaves, and magnetic waves are able to change matter in ways we never dreamt to be possible. So maybe this is what the ancients really looked for, is a way to exit the reality that's around us, or the way to condition one's perception. We know right now from quantum physics that the world around us is really not what it is. There's an agreement on it, called consensus reality. The world around us is what our mind is constructing, and that can be changed. And sound can affect that. Meditation and so many things that we can do can affect the world as we see it. This microphone is really not there. Somehow my brain and all of our minds agree that this is a microphone. But as scientists are analyzing particles and subatomic particle level, they realize that there's nothing solid, it's all energy. And that energy can be influenced by your observation. We've known about this for a long time, since the 40s. It's called Heisenberg's measurement problem. So if a scientist is conducting an experiment, just the fact that the scientist is observing would make the experiment go in a specific way. If there's no one observing, the experiment would go in a different way. Kind of, you know, scientists there with an intention, similar to Emoto's work, right, with water crystals. He's someone, if you're interested in sound, mystical understanding of sound, get Hazrat Inayat Khan, amazing writing on sound. So, to address some of the the monuments that the ancients have built, some of the strangest acoustical chambers. This is one of them in Malta, Hal Safiyani Hypogeum in Malta, and this is from 3,000 years ago. Scientists and archaeologists estimated that it must have taken them about 20 years to dig it in bedrock. And one of the chambers inside is constructed in a way where a person can have a mystical experience from sound, just with talking, let alone playing conch shells or instruments. So you can definitely alter your consciousness. And we find structures like this in a wide variety of different places. This is the one that archaeologists and scientists are talking about the most. There's a great article in about it in Popular Archaeology magazine. Another ancient civilization that were expert in sound and acoustics is Chavin culture, a pre-Incan civilization. This is an area where that you can still go and visit in northern Peru, Chavin de Huentar. We scientists right now are studying their knowledge in acoustics and how they dug tunnels and chambers to allow a person to experience an altered state of consciousness and play conch shells. And some of them were found there, and they sound like this. Another thing that the ancients resorted to is this little ocarina-like instrument. But when you blow into it, you hear one high-pitched sound. And if you have four or more together and you play them, have you heard of tripping from sound? That's what happened. It's as if someone came and changed the channel on your receiver, your brain. Literally, it's phenomenal. And every person back then had a Peruvian whistling vessel, and they would get together and play them in small or large groups. And it's quite an experience. No hallucinogens used. This is just some sound. So, in Indian classical music, if you're interested in hearing what overtones sound like, Well, this instrument is the simplest one to play, but also the most important one in any ensemble. The tampura or tambura is usually played by the student accompanying the master. All the person does is play four open strings, and these notes are changed from one piece to another based on the rag that is being utilized. And it sounds like this. Listen to the connection between the notes that are sung in the voice and the notes in the instrument. You get the idea. So basically, these notes and overtones are ringing to guide the musician, instrumentalist, or singer, or group of them to several notes that are important to use as a guide, but also when they play in alap, which is an improvisation improvisatory section, they're subconsciously or consciously being influenced by the harmonic series that they're hearing emanating from the notes played on these open strings that would guide them as to where it's good to go. It's an inspiration, it's a guidance, it's a framework, it's very highly essential thing. Now, you know, it's hard to get a musician and this instrument to lug around. They use small boxes, electronic boxes, just to generate that drone. You do lose some things, but it's still important, so we cannot bypass. Now, you can hear also harmonic overtones on Tibetan bowls. And it's important to mention the complex metallurgy that are used in making these instruments. Science of metallurgy is sophisticated chemistry. Look into any metallurgy book in the library or just online, and you'll see the level of science that's in it. We have no idea how the ancients, especially in India, Nepal, Tibet, or Himalaya area, and the Far East as well, have worked these metals, the right proportion, to get an instrument that when you hit it, you get complex alignment of harmonic overtones. They really went out of the way to construct an instrument like a gong or a disc or a bell or Tibetan bowl that you can hold and do something to yourself, really personal, that can be a shortcut to altered state of consciousness. So that's not sitting around and trying to construct something, or, you know, that's great length of hard work and research and knowledge. Where they got this knowledge, we have no idea. And so they were after sound for good reasons. So just give you an idea of the overtones here. Okay, sorry. I'm rushing a bit because there's a few more slides I want to show you. This is a very interesting short film. This is Samaveda chanting. Samaveda is the last section of the Vedas, Hindu scriptures. And this is a brain scan, and you can see how different areas in the brain would light up.
Akuparehe, Gayatri Chandaha, Indra Mahaganapatir Devata.
So Arabic classical music, this is what I was talking about earlier, about tarab. But so tarab is an altered state of consciousness achieved through judicious, attentive listening. It's often described as high levels of euphoria, of enchantment, of ecstasy, and that's shared by both the audience and the performers, and both parts are heavily reliant on each other. If great instrumentalist, musician, or singer, or a bunch of them gave a concert and there were no judicious listeners in the audience, they're not going to give a great performance. They need the feedback. They need the energetic support, but they need to hear it as well and feel it. And the more they hear it, the more they give. So it's about the communion, the energetic communion. And people lose themselves in the performance. I mean, fascinating. There's a woman who was almost perceived as a cult leader. This is probably one of the most internationally known musicians to have ever lived. Now, think about it. This is a woman in an Islamic conservative society in Egypt. Was born in 1904, started becoming famous in the 30s, up until the day she died. There were 2 million people in her funeral. When she gave a concert the first Thursday of the month, life came to a halt in the Middle East. No one did anything. Everybody was on radio or on TV. She had power over major politicians, Abdel Nasser, businessmen, intellectuals, the best musicians played in her orchestra. The best poets and composers wrote music for her. Why? What gives a woman in a conservative society such power that not only she was known as a famous, good musician, but she had a major role in the social, cultural, political, intellectual life as well because of her artistry, because of what she was able to induce in people. True transcendence, true healing, giving people an opportunity to go to her concert or listen to their cassette tapes at home. I mean, everybody's into her, those who know a lot about music and those who don't know anything. The street vendor and the sophisticated poet and composer all would review her in the same way. This is a great book about Umm Kulthum. There's also a documentary that's kind of a very reduced version of the book. I would highly recommend the book if you have no time. Just get that. Here's another musician who is still alive, who had power over the former dictator Hafez Assad, who was president for almost 30 years in Syria. His son now is a president. And why? Because of his artistry, yeah. Another musician, Munir Bashir. This guy had huge influence on Saddam Hussein, a ruthless dictator who you would think had no affinity for music. But once again, he would bow down to this guy. He would do anything this guy would suggest. He's dead now. Not to forget also Hitler's, for example, obsession with sound. So this is what sound can do. It can tame even the untamable. Why? Because when it's performed well and when you're addressing the musical culture with the right mathematical, the musical mathematical ratios, things can be very, very different in your mind and in the outside world. Sound meditation. So after I researched all of this and came to it with my background. I spent 12 years studying music, studied different areas of music, theory, composition, ethnomusicology, and I played different musical styles and cultures and different instruments. So I think I'm pretty well-rounded, but I was astonished at all the findings that I started coming on to, things that I never heard about, never assumed, or things were addressed very briefly during my education. Like, for example, musicians would study about harmonic overtones, but it's kind of something in passing. They don't spend so much time on them because we don't have the understanding. Things started surfacing when I started bringing my knowledge of meditation and started scrutinizing further the literature and the narratives that the ancients have in the holy books in Hinduism, Buddhism, Sikhism, Brahmanism, Jainism, and Burmism as well. And in the way shamans in all societies have used sound, sacrament might change, but sound is always there. The shaman might be offering ayahuasca or peyote or San Pedro or mushrooms, etc. But sound is always there. It's not superfluous. It's not for entertainment. It must be doing something. So I wanted to understand why it's there, and started asking questions and doing all the research, because sound, as I see it, is the healer. Everybody looked for it. Even us. Do you want evidence? Watch what's happening in the world. We are the best subjects. The world is the best laboratory. We don't need to theorize. Look what is being done with music right now, and look how much music has taken huge part in any religion, and how music was tamed and adjusted and limited, or further revered in Sufism, for example, in so many religious sects. Music is a very major thing. It's a thing to have and to use as an element. Same for meditations, whether you're Buddhist or Hindu. And the structure of all these churches and cathedrals, that's nice Templars build. So when you go inside a space like that with immaculate architecture and acoustics, and you hear music, what are you going to experience? Elated feeling, God. And we associate that with the church or with this religion, this, you know. No. This is sound on your brain. And you can actually, there are several scientists who are using this tactic, subjecting the brain to electromagnetic energy. Michael Persinger is one of them, created the God Helmet. He's a professor at Laurentian University in Montreal. You wear this helmet and you sit, and he would subject you to different electromagnetic energy, and he would manipulate things from the next room, and all of a sudden you start to have a feeling of presence of another or an entity or something, as if you're having apparition. So, but sound can impact our consciousness to levels that we have no idea. You probably do have some idea, because I know you all love music. And that's another thing, we never ask, well, why are we obsessed with music? Music is the most popular art form, whether we want it or not. Not everybody goes to art galleries and museums and poetry reading and dance performances, because music is convenient. We can still drive the car or read that book or exercise or do whatever we want, clean the apartment while still listening to music. You don't need to dedicate time for it. This is a very important thing. Plus, music is penetrating your subconscious mind and changing things. It's better if you're sitting and listening and not doing something else, but it's still pleasurable even if you don't have the time or the interest in doing that. But if you sit and listen, you can go to places. So you encourage me to put all of this stuff together in a format to teach people something about sound and about themselves as well. And then I started encountering all sorts of things that went beyond my expertise, which is music, having to deal with neurochemistry and quantum physics and a lot of, slowed down the research, but made it much, much more fascinating. So the brain has five gears: delta state, theta state, alpha, beta, and gamma. The numbers might differ a little bit. They're often judged in hertz. So this is 0.5 to 3 hertz here. Sometimes you see 4. But as long as you remember that the delta brainwave cycle, delta waves, are things you experience when you're asleep, but not dreaming. Theta wave, I don't like so much the description right here. They could be more elaborate and more accurate. So the theta state is basically when you're in deep state of meditation. The alpha state is state of awareness. It's not a very deep state of meditation. It's you're kind of getting there, or you're sitting and not doing any activity, you're not thinking so much. The beta state is when you're doing a hard task that requires presence and concentration. Okay? The gamma state, it's not just hyper brain activity, it's also the aha state, the eureka state. This is the state that inventors, scientists, artists tend to visit a lot, tend to want to visit a lot. It's almost as if we tap into material or knowledge, data from a different dimension. So, it's hard to read here, I think I need to enlarge it. This is a wishful thinking. I found this somewhere. Basically, it shows you that what you can do with what frequency in what brainwave cycle, but I think at some point we'll be able to decode the receiver, because a lot of scientists right now agree that consciousness is not created by the brain, it's tapped into by the brain. And I firmly believe in that, and the more I study ancient scriptures and look into their practices, the more I'm realizing that, yeah, it's about changing things for us by filtering and watching the mind. This is why it's important to be mindful and always monitoring one's mind. The average person has 60,000 thoughts a day. How many of them are important? And some, a lot of them are micro thoughts. Like right now, you just had about 5 or 6 of them. Right now, another 5. So, they're a fraction of a second, just undetectable even. So, it's very important to watch this wandering of the mind, and especially when we're now going through our busy day, because this is what causes a lot of fatigue, and accumulated fatigue and suppressed feelings and traumas and loops over loops and habitual patterns over others tend to manifest in ailments, physical or psychological, emotional. So I did an EEG testing with the sound meditation. Is Kevin here? Kevin, yeah. Kevin was my collaborator. He was running the EEG, and his wonderful fiancée, Catherine, is she here as well? No. She was our delightful subject. We cherished her and treated her not like a common subject. So we basically tested the instruments that I use in the sound meditation on her. We put electrodes and laid her down, and we were using a Mac. There's a wonderful software called IBVA, which shows you amazing graphs like that in 3D. And basically, this is here the brain waves and the hertz. Okay, this is all the activities. So the lowest it is, blue, for example, is very low activity. It goes to green, the dark green, and the light green moves on. This is really high peaks of, needless to say. And then as you're working, whatever you do on the person, whether giving them a cucumber or playing gong for them or slapping them or just various things, you see it right away on the screen. Fantastic. And you can do a lot of experimentation with this. I have no idea. Yeah. What's on your list, Santa? So, and this moves this way. It basically moves that way both, and they fall. There's a dip right there. It's like a waterfall. Really great. So, this is a baseline. This is before we did anything. She was just playing now. Large gong. So, left hemisphere, right hemisphere. Now here we zeroed in. This is 0 hertz, 4 hertz, 8, 12, and goes on. You can zoom out, zoom in. But look what it did. From this to this. Things are very quiet. You don't need to know a lot about how to read EEGs. This is with a small gong. Look at the synchrony, how in various levels, whether beta, theta, alpha, delta, theta, alpha, and beta, and gamma, pretty calm, and also same similar things in both hemispheres. This is Shruti box. I'll play it later on. It's an Indian instrument that produces a wide range of overtones. Tibetan singing bowls, very, very unique. This is something that was very rare. We didn't witness with other instruments. No wonder why Himalayans, Nepalese or Tibetans or Indians spend so much effort to have this band only there. This is an eye movement. When you blink your eye, you get this sharpie. But to have this high ridge right there around the 50 to 60 hertz, it's very unique. Small Japanese belt, small chimes. Tuning forks.
Thank you.